and the national protest in America has been Black Lives Matter. And today, this is my Buddhist topic. I want you to look here, and I'm going to show you a picture of an African-American female priest. She's a Buddhist priest, and her name is Mukay Shonin. Now, the reason that we show Mukay Shonin on our picture, the reason that we're discussing Mukay Shonin, because her relationship to, she and I, relates to Black Lives Matter, and it relates to the subject of Buddhism. Now, and I think it's about August of 2010, CNN did a story on Mukay Shonin, and it was called Black in America, and they were discussing religion. And of course, Mukay Shonin is the first woman in the West, Black or white or Japanese, to become a Nichiren priest. This is a fantastic achievement that Mukay Shonin made. Of course, Mukay Shonin, her mother is Japanese, and her father, of course, is African-American, but she's an African-American Nichiren shoe priest of the Nichiren sect. Now, CNN did a story on Mukay Shonin, and of course, when they did a story on Black in America, they did this story based upon the fact that this is an African-American Nichiren shoe priest, or an African-American female Buddhist priest. Now, what we have concerns about in regards to Mukay Shonin, while she is an African-American Nichiren shoe priest, this does not mean that she actually relates to the African-American community. In fact, most Buddhists that you find do not relate to the African-American community. You will find that if you would study or look at pure evidence of African-Americans who practice Buddhism, you would find that almost 100% of the African-Americans have a Japanese or an Asian mindset, in that they study or they participate in the type of Buddhism that's dominated by Asians, and they are of the mentality, whereas they do not bring in or even consider an African or African-American cultural paradigm. These African-Americans that get in these positions do not really look out for the interests of African-Americans, but primarily or particularly, they look after the interests of Japanese, because that is what they're trained to do. Now, in 2013, 1 year ago, I had left the Nichiren Shoshu Buddhist sect, and I was looking to join Nichiren Shu. Now, I have been a Nichiren Buddhist for over 40 years. And of course, for in the 1980s, I saw SGI, that's the Soka Gakkai International Japanese leader, Daisaku Ikeda, get rid of all of us Black people in Buddhism. And he did a strategic plan to get rid of African-American males. SGI leader Daisaku Ikeda put Black females in a position, and they created a paradigm of having African-Americans who practice Buddhism with a practice of cultural neutrality, in that African-Americans do not particularly look after African-Americans or practice Buddhism in a way that's culturally inclusive. Now, I, in turn, left the SGI about 1991, which I wrote a letter, which you can see at the end of this telecast. You can click on it. I wrote a letter to NSA friends because I was a part of an organization called Nichiren Shoshu of America. And when I left the organization, I joined a sect called Nichiren Shoshu, which was the parent organization of the SGI, and they got into this big, nasty battle that even goes on to this day. And I was thinking that when I joined Nichiren Shoshu, Nichiren Shoshu had opened up a temple in Accra, Ghana, and I was thinking that these Japanese people had a concern for African Americans and that they opened the first Nichiren Shoshu temple in Africa. I only learned later that what they did was they carefully and strategically got us African Americans involved, thinking that we would be part of the organization of equality. We was thinking that we were practicing Buddhism of freedom, justice, and equality, only to find out that we were practicing a Buddhism of Japanese nationalism. Now, in 2013, I began to go to the Nichiren Shoshu meetings because a person who I introduced to Buddhism over 20 years ago, Mr. Shaka Kafani, who I considered a friend, Shaka had joined the Nichiren Shoshu organization, and his teacher was African-American Nichiren Shoshu priest Muke Shonin. When I met with Shaka, I said, listen, Shaka, I'm leaving Nichiren Shoshu. I would love to come practice with Nichiren Shoshu. Let us begin to teach a true Buddhism, a Buddhism of equality, a Buddhism of freedom, a Buddhism of justice, and a Buddhism, most of all, that's inclusive of our African and African-American culture and history. Shaka agreed to this. And we started, look at some of the pictures, we started going to meetings at Shaka's house. And I said, Shaka, we're going to call this organization Memphis Proud Black Buddhist. And the reason that we wanted to call it Memphis Proud Black Buddhist is that we wanted to delineate ourselves from other Buddhists by saying we would have a Buddhism inclusive, not exclusive, but we would have a Buddhism that's inclusive of our African and African-American culture and history. Soon thereafter, when Shaka reported this information to his priest, Muke Shonin, Muke Shonin objected. She says, oh no, you cannot have an organization called Memphis Proud Black Buddhists, because you are going to get white folk upset. You cannot call this a sangha. A sangha is a Buddhist community. They had a problem with us calling the organization a sangha. They said, no, you're trying to start a different religion. And Shaka wrote me a real nasty letter and said I could kiss his ass. And the reason he wrote this letter, because I wrote a formal letter to Muke Shonin and Nichiren Shoshu leaders, and I asked them what was their policy in regards to African and African Americans. And Shaka wrote a very nasty letter and says, man, you are not welcome at my house anymore. I don't want to have anything to do with you anymore. And you can kiss my ass. This, ladies and gentlemen, is the mentality of Nichiren Shoshu Buddhists or African Americans who have to identify with their African heritage. So in order for these African Americans to identify with their African heritage, they have to disregard or deny that they are black people. We are African people of, we are American people of African descent. There's nothing wrong with being an African American Buddhist sect. In fact, There's something great about it. Now, look at this picture of Mukesh Shonin, and I want you to see, and I want you to understand, ladies and gentlemen, the mentality. Our lecture is called what? It's called Black Lives Matter. Now, if Mukesh Shonin, a person of African descent whose father was African American, you would think that she'd be proud to have African Americans who can stand proud of their African heritage. Now, but what you have is a difference. Now, ladies and gentlemen, this Friday, a new movie is opening in America. It's called Selma. Now, why is Selma important? The movie Selma is important because the movie Selma actually has an interrelated relationship to me, Anthony Elmore, as a Buddhist, and it explains who I am as a Buddhist. Now, Mr. Shaka Kafane, who is a Nichiren Shu Buddhist, says, my knowledge of Buddhism is shallow. And what I can let Mr. Shaka Kafane know and let all the other Buddhists know, certainly my knowledge of Buddhism is shallow in terms of their style of Buddhism, because Anthony Elmore is a person who has not been orientated and who does not accept Japanese nationalism. The kind of Buddhism that they teach is Japanese nationalism. In fact, a few years ago, I was at Taisekaji, Japan, at the head Nichiren Shoshu Temple. I want you to see a brother in New York who is a Nichiren Shoshu leader. His name is Tony. Tony got upset because we had a Proud Black Buddhist website, and Tony was of the mentality. Tony says that anything that does not come from a Nichiren Shoshu priest ain't real. Never in my life have I ever heard of such ignorance of brainwashing of African American people. Here this guy is supposed to be an intelligent guy, and he says anything that don't come from a Nichiren Shoshu priest ain't real. Now, there's another brother. His name is Bobby Hudson. This brother is so brainwashed that all he can think about is Daisaku Ikeda, the man who used brainwashing to trap other people into his kind of Buddhist religion. Now, what I want you to see, ladies and gentlemen, what I want you to look at right now, you know, the movie Selma is coming about. Now, Shaka says, I do not have or my knowledge of Buddhism is shallow. Yes, Shaka, my knowledge of Buddhism is shallow. However, Anthony Elmore is not a shallow person because it is the Lotus Sutra that teaches. The Lotus Sutra, it says, they relate to secular matters in terms, they relate to Buddhism, or they relate to secular matters in terms of Buddhism. But the Lotus Sutra teaches that secular matters are the entirety of Buddhism. And since secular matters are the entirety of Buddhism, we have to account for our knowledge and our orientation about life. Now, when you deal in Buddhism, you should deal with someone who has a worldview, not someone that has a myopic view of a Japanese person who teaches you a Buddhism of Japanese nationalism. Now, I want you to see a video. Now, the video is a scene from a movie. It's only about 30 seconds scene in a movie. It was a movie I shot in 1988 called A Contemporary Gladiator. Now, It's about my becoming the world kickboxing champion. But in the movie, I tell my story. And there was one important event in my life. That is when I was 19 years old. In 1971 and 1972, the person who started, who suggested the idea of civil rights legislation, the person, the mind guy, the mindset, the brilliant mind, the who started Selma. Now, when you look at the movie Selma from Montgomery, Selma to Montgomery to the Capitol, it was a man by the name of James Bevel. Now, ladies and gentlemen, the Gosho of Buddhism teaches that you know a bodhisattva or a Buddha how he acts as a human being. When I was 19 years old, ladies and gentlemen, I was an individual dedicated to the cause of freedom, justice, and equality. And I was a student at the University of Memphis. And while I was a student at the University of Memphis, when I was 18 years old, I led the first 18-year-old voter registration in the state of Tennessee. I got you together. I was involved into the struggle of freedom, justice, and equality before I ever met Buddhism, because I did these things in high school. And when I got to college, I was a dedicated youth. Are dedicated to bringing freedom, justice, and equality of all humanity. And what happened was, I heard at Lemoyne College, there was a man who I need to go hear. This man's name was James Bevel. I want you to see a scene of James Bevel and I meeting James Bevel. James Bevel affected my life so much, ladies and gentlemen, that when I was a student at the University of Memphis, I quit college and decided that I would dedicate my life to the uplift of freedom, justice, and equality. I want you to now take a look at a scene of my meeting Reverend Bevel. Now, one thing that you would see, and I want to show you some pictures, in the movie Selma, the rapper, I think it's Cannon, the rap star Cannon, is playing James Bevel. Now they said James Bevel's a little crazy. But now understand, ladies and gentlemen, that I, at 19 years old, I had a chance to be around some of the most dedicated civil rights leaders in the history of America. When I was only 18 years old, I used to go to Seminary Methodist Church, and there was a man by the name of James Lawson. Reverend Lawson was the man who got Dr. Martin Luther King to come to Memphis. Reverend Lawson was a Methodist minister who went to school in India. He studied Mohandas Gandhi's theory of passive resistance. Now, there I was with Reverend James Lawson. I knew Reverend Billy Cowles. I knew all the top people in the civil rights movement because I lived with these people. In fact, in 1972, I was a delegate for the first black political convention in Gary, Indiana in 1972. So I had a background, ladies and gentlemen, a background of working for freedom, justice, and equality. Now, when I came into the Buddhist religion, I was looking for a religion that helps you to continue your path of freedom, justice, and equality. Let's look at James Bevel. In the scene of I mean James Bevel, and let's come back and let's talk about it and let's put a period on this lecture. Let's look at James Bevel, and we'll talk more about it.
Sociologists and psychologists, man, they ain't never learned nothing like this before.
Well, son, stick with me. I'll teach you more in 2 months than they can teach you in 2 years at the university. Stick with me, and God bless you.
Now, in the scene, you see me telling Reverend Bevel that the things that he was teaching, I didn't learn things like that in college. And Reverend Bevel says, son, you hang with me, I'll teach you more in 2 months than you learn 2 years going to the university. Ladies and gentlemen, as a youth, I hung out with the civil rights leaders. I was with Reverend James Bevel. I was with all the civil rights leaders and the people who actually made history. Now, what is important, like the movie Selma. The movie Selma has been nominated for so many awards, Golden Globe and so many great awards. And the reason that it's been nominated because this movie is really one of the first movies or one of the few movies that tells a black perspective. Ladies and gentlemen, we need black perspectives because what the movie tells, the movie shows Dr. Martin Luther King as human. See, we have this television image of Dr. King. Most people don't know that Dr. King smoked cigarettes. Most people don't know the human side of Dr. King. See, I was with Bevel, ladies and gentlemen. We lived together. We traveled together. We did things together. We marched together. We cried together. I was deep into the movement. So, when I set an organization called Proud Black Buddhists, I do not bring a Japanese paradigm to the table. I bring the paradigm of the spirit of those who have traveled the true bodhisattva road. See, a bodhisattva is not a so-called perfect person. Dr. Martin Luther King, ladies and gentlemen, what you don't know and what I know, Dr. King was a rock star. Dr. King was a man of high charisma. And women love Dr. King. And Dr. King loved women. Now, you don't see this part of Dr. King. You don't see Dr. King who smoked cigarettes. You don't see Dr. King who loved women and women loved Dr. King. But I, being a person who came up in the movement, understood these things. In fact, the former First Lady, Jackie Kennedy, hated Dr. King, because the FBI put tapes on Dr. King and they knew about all the affairs that Dr. King had because Dr. King had women in every town he went to. He was a man, he was a young man, and he loved women. Now, we have this television or this so-called role that a man is going to be so-called inhuman, or this so-called Christian idea of being God-like. Dr. King was a man like everybody else. But what was special about him, he was dedicated to the movement. Dr. King was dedicated to freedom, justice, and equality. And the reason that I mention this, ladies and gentlemen, because a bodhisattva is not some so-called perfect person. The Buddha, Shakyamuni, in the Lotus Sutra teaches us that we have 10,000 worlds. Or we live in 3,000 worlds in a moment's terror state of existence, and we live in the 10 worlds. In the 10 worlds, we can go from hell all the way to Buddhahood and experience all the other worlds in between. But we, who, whether you are a Buddhist or not, we practice the Buddha Dharma. That is right living, right thinking. We practice the Dharma of the Buddha, and the Dharma is right living, right concentration. That is what Buddhism is, ladies and gentlemen. Now, with Anthony Elmore, no, I am not trained by Japanese. I don't have the Japanese orientation like a Bobby Hudson who worships a Daisaku Kata. But I have the highest respect for a man like Dr. Martin Luther King. I have the highest respect for Thich Nhat Hanh, who challenged the government about the Vietnam War. Dr. King did what was right about the Vietnam War when Daisaku Kata didn't say a thing. Daisaku Kata did not say anything, but it was Dr. Martin Luther King and Buddhist priest Thich Nhat Hanh. It was those Buddhist priests during the Vietnam War who set themselves on fire to be heard. These are the people, ladies and gentlemen, who Anthony M. Elmore followed. Now, I want you to look at a picture. There's me with John Lewis. John Lewis is a congressman. But if you ever meet John Lewis and you feel his spirit, this man has a compassion for freedom, justice, and equality. Whether Buddhist or non-Buddhist, this man is a highly remarkable person if you meet John Lewis. If you look at another picture, there's me with Harry Belafonte. During the night of the I Have a Dream speech, the night before Harry Belafonte, Dr. Martin Luther King stayed at Harry Belafonte's house. When he died, it was Harry Belafonte there with Coretta Scott King. So the Harry Belafonte is in the Dick Gregory's. And when you look at these type of people, I talked to Dick Gregory on the phone just a year ago. I was in Washington, D.C. with Congressman Steve Cohen, and me and Congressman John Lewis, who is in the movie Selman. We talked about Bevel because Bevel was his roommate in college. People like Dana Nash and people like Reverend Vivian. These are people that actually got into the movement. These are the struggles. These are the pioneers. These are the people that fight. And these are the people who Anthony F. Elmore associates with. And this is the spirit where I learned to be a proud Black Buddhist, proud of who you are. So, I just want to show you this, to show you that there is a difference. You can follow a person like Bobby Hudson, who follows the Japanese nationalist SGI leader Daisaku Kata. You can go to Tony, who follows the Nichiren Shoshu priest, and you can follow their type of Buddhism, or you can go to Mukai Shonin, who agrees with the fact that they don't want an African-American come to their meetings because they don't want you bringing up anything about Blackness. But ladies and gentlemen, when you look on the world stage, even though those people don't say anything, the top story of 2014 was Black Lives Matter. And Black lives are important, and it is important to have an African and African-American perspective because we live in a world of diversity. My name is Anthony F. Elmore, president of the Proud Black Buddhist Association. I don't follow Japanese, my Japanese brothers, but I practice Buddhism with my own culture. And we are the most suited. We are the Proud Black Buddhists. Have a good day. Anthony F. Elmore, Proud Black Buddhist World Association. Look on our website, www.proudblackbuddhist.org. Thank you very much.
the Lord suits you. Forward. Your dreams will now come true.
Forward.
Forward. A new life forward. Is waiting on
forward.
You.
Let's
don't look forward. Backwards.
Forward.
See things through.
Forward.
Forward. Follow the Lord will suit you.
Forward.
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 Make your dreams
forward.
Come true.
Forward.
That's the thing
forward.
To do.
Forward.
Forward. What they call
forward.
True Buddhism.
Forward.
It's Japanese
forward.
Nationalism.
Forward.
Forward. It's a form of racism.
Forward. Forward.
Follow the Lord of Sutra.
Move forward.
It's what
forward.
You do.